So there is a famous meme which often makes its way around the internet. I'm pretty sure we all know what a meme is, but for those who don't, a meme is essentially an image which becomes popular online, often because of something comedic in the image, and then people kind of add their own little stuff to it. So this meme, if you can show it up, here we go, is of three versions of Spider-Man, and the collective memory is actually that all three are pointing at each other. And I was convinced of that as well until I started preparing for the sermon, and I noticed that the guy on the left actually has a clenched fist and not actually pointing. But I need to encourage you to think of this meme with the collective memory of all the Spider-Men pointing at each other, okay? Ignore the clenched fist concept. So we're going to jump into that idea, and you might recall a few months ago I preached on the Trinity. I mentioned that there are that the three persons of the Trinity are constantly trying to glorify the other. The late Timothy Keller, in his book King's Cross, describes this as a type of dance that the person of the Trinity kind of go through, this spiral dance where they're all trying to dance around the other. They're trying to make the other the center of the dance, and so this is kind of the spiral motion always going on as they're trying to glorify the other of the Trinity. Well, this meme, as silly as it is another way of kind of trying to understand the relationship of the persons of the Trinity. Though, I will say again what I've said last time, because every time we try and understand the Trinity using an image, the thing we have to remember all the time is we are created beings trying to understand the Creator. And so every image that we come up with, every analogy that we might use to describe the Trinity will always fall short, because we're trying to use created things to explain the Creator. So this is a cool one, but it's not perfect. It's got its flaws. So this is how this meme tells us about the Trinity. Firstly, every character in this picture is the same character. They are all Spider-Man. Just as every person in the Trinity is God. Okay? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Secondly, each character in the meme is trying to draw attention away from themselves and direct it towards the other two, just as the persons of the Trinity seek to glorify the other instead of themselves. Okay? That's number two. Number three, each character in the meme has a unique costume. If you look at it, they all kind of have different costumes. Just as each person in the Trinity is unique in their personhood. Okay, great. This is all working well. Number four, the unique costumes in this meme, however, just briefly, the unique costumes in this meme reveal the flaw of this analogy when talking about the Trinity. Because each costume being unique shows that each Spider-Man is actually a different Spider-Man. That they are not the same. That they are three separate, completely different, unique people. And this is where the problem comes into the Trinity, because we say the Trinity is all God. So these are three different Spider-Men. They're not all the same Spider-Man that are different. God is one God, yet different persons. So think of this. Keep it in your mind. You can switch it off to me, but keep that in your mind as we talk through the sermon. So the question is, what does this meme have to do with the sermon today? Yes, Malik.
Means that trying to do is we try to be like freaking dogs, because dogs, they can't explain it,
because they can't understand it. Yes. Yes. So what does this meme have to do with the sermon today? Well, last week we started speaking about the Father. Okay, this is on the ongoing series talking about good theology and how good theology leads to great worship, and we spoke about how the Word, the Scriptures, the Bible, and Jesus, the Son of God, reveal the Father to us and the characteristics of the Father. We kind of dove into that. We looked through the whole Old Testament and the different characteristics of God being Father to Israel, and what does that mean for us today, and how the New Testament takes this image and expands on it. So we spoke all about that last week. Now, this week, or today, I want to talk about how we see the Son and the Spirit both pointing to and glorifying the Father, but also how the Father then glorifies the Son and the Spirit, much like the Spider-Man meme. They're kind of all pointing to one another. So we're going to read two passages. The first one is from John chapter 17, if you want to open up to that. And the second one is from Romans chapter 8, so it's only a few pages after that. So John chapter 17, And we're going to read from verse 20. Let me just get it open here. John 17, and from verse 20 to the end of the chapter, and then jumping to Romans 8. By the way, if you're visiting, most welcome. My name is Andrew. I'm the minister here at the church. So John 17, from verse 20 to 26. My prayer is not for them alone. This is Jesus praying, and he's talking about the disciples when he says, not for them alone. So my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, and that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me, and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am, and to see my glory, the glory you have given me, because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them, and will continue to make you known, in order that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. Then jump to Romans chapter 8, so two books from here. Romans chapter 8, from verse 14 to 17. Romans chapter 8, from verse 14 to 17. Paul writes, "For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you might live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs of Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We read from John chapter 17 a couple of weeks ago, but we only read from verse 1 to verse 19. And I encourage you to go and read the rest of the prayer, because it is such a beautiful prayer. It's one of my favorite chapters in the Bible, and in the New Testament specifically. In the section that we read today of John 17, we see just how Jesus prays for all of those who come to believe in him through the ministry and the work of the apostles, which means that Jesus also prayed for us. We have come to believe him through the ongoing work that the apostles started, has been passed on generation to generation to generation, till we are here, gathered at the tip southern point of Africa, as we celebrate Jesus Christ, who lived in the Middle East. But this work of the apostles passed down from generation to generation means we came to believe in Christ, and so he prays for us too. And what was Jesus' prayer for us? His prayer was quite simple, that we may be one, just as the Father and the Son are one. Our unity with each other is based on our unity with the Father through the Son by the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's because of our unity with the Father that we will then be joining in the glorification of the Son. And we will share in this beautiful moment, just as the Son, the Father has glorified the Son, we will be there and share in this ultimate glory moment, which, can you just imagine what that would look like? And it's through the Son's glorification of the Father and the Father's glorification of the Son that we are then brought into complete unity with God and with each other. Simply put, because the Father sent the Son and has given us the Spirit, we are able to be one body. This is really kind of what Paul's argument is. We are one because of God. And it is through our unity with one another that the world will know that the Father sent the Son and that the Father loves us. And I think this is such a challenge for us in the world today, and as churches, and Table View specifically. Something I've been trying to do is trying to get the ministers fraternal, the pastors fraternal up and going in Tel Aviv again because it died many years ago. It is difficult. Churches don't want to work with one another. And how horrible is that? But we read in the scripture, we read here, that our unity with each other shows the world that the Father sent the Son and just how much the Father loves us. It is evidence. The Father's love is evidenced by the sending of the Son. Think John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. The fact that Jesus came is proof that our Father in heaven loves us. Okay? So that's where we're at. In verse 24, we see once again Jesus talking about the glory the Father has given him because of the love of this for the Son. So the Father has given or glorified Jesus. Why? Because he loves him. We spoke about this also when we spoke about the Trinity, about this eternal love that exists between the persons of the Trinity, and that is why we can say God is love. So the Father seeks to glorify the Son because he loves him. The Son seeks to glorify the Father because he loves him. It is a glorification based on love. It reminds us, if you look back to the very first verse of this prayer in John 17, where Jesus says, glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. It is this pointing towards each other, this dancing around each other, this constant seeking to make the other the center. Point to me so that I may point to you. Dance around me so that I may dance around you. This is the whole concept. The Father loves the Son, and the Son loves the Father. The Son glorified the Father through his love for him and his work here on earth and his continuing redemptive work in our lives. Jesus didn't just come, teach, die, rise, ascend, and then that's it. He doesn't just sit and do nothing until something happens. He's constantly working in our lives. We spoke about this on Thursday at the Ascension Day service, where we spoke about the Son is interceding for us. He's preparing a place for us. It is this ongoing work that Jesus Christ is doing for us. So the Son glorifies the Father glorifies the Son. And the Son, one of the wonderful ways that the Son glorifies the Father is by bringing all of those who love him to the Father. He's this interceder, this kind of person that leads the charge and says, here's my people who love me, into the presence of the Father. The Father, on the other hand, so this is how the Son glorifies the Father. The Father, on the other hand, glorifies the Son by giving him the name that is above all name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so if this is the Father and the Son, and this is how they kind of operate with each other, what about the Spirit? So we've spoken a lot about the Father and the Son. In this passage we read from John, is Jesus talking to the Father. So we've got the Father and the Son. So what about the Spirit? Well, we really saw in our passage last week that we read, which was different to this week's, but very, very similar in language, if you might remember, that the Spirit is given to us by the Father, and that it is by this power of the Spirit that we are able to call out Abba, Father. That we're able to know God as our Father. It is because of the Spirit. And we read that again in this week's passage, which is very similar. In Romans, Paul once again takes this image of God being Father that we find in the New Testament, Old Testament, that Jesus took and expanded on, and expands on it even more by making it very clear that those who are led by the Spirit of God are in fact God's children. We cannot be filled with the Spirit and not be a child of God, and we cannot be a child of God and not be led and filled by the Spirit. The two are synonymous, they go together. Because the Spirit is the one who brought about our adoption into God's family. Jesus' death and resurrection made it possible for us to be adopted, but the Spirit is the one who does it. He's the one that brings us fully into fellowship with the Father. I love talking like this because it helps us understand that each person in your Trinity is unique. The Son is vital to the redemption story of the world. And he opens a door that the Spirit then completes, that they work together constantly. We are therefore, because of the Spirit's work in us, and because the Spirit's bringing us into adoption to God's family, we're therefore not slaves to sin and death anymore. But rather we are free in Christ, and we are children of the Most High God. That is to whom we belong. Today is Mother's Day, and what a beautiful day. If you didn't see my little letter that I've written, I've got a letter that I wrote, it's in the foyer as you leave, feel free to grab it. But I write about Mother's Day, and I write about how so many women are biological mothers or adoptive mothers, but there are many women who are mothers in different ways as well. Okay? Parenting is complex. And we find ourselves with many different mothers and fathers and things like that in the world. And the beautiful thing about mothers, whether biological or adoptive or spiritual or whatever, is they I don't want to say never, because sometimes life is extremely difficult, but it is extremely rare for a mother to give up completely on her child. Moms hold on. They love, they care, they support. No matter how wonky the child gets, they are there, all right? And what's beautiful about this image of God being our Father is, and that it says we are no longer slave to sin. Sometimes we find ourselves deep in sin. Sometimes we find ourselves captive to various addictions and things like that are deep in sin. Yes, that is true. But the Spirit of God has brought about our adoption into God's family, makes it that we are never not God's child if we give our lives to Him. We will always be His child, no matter how far we might find ourselves trapped by sin. God still is there, He still loves, just as a mom never gives up on her child, God doesn't give up on us. That's the beauty of being in God's family, in full status adoption as children of the Most High God. As I said last week, Paul also is very deliberate in the language he uses, because he doesn't just say we are children, he says we are sons. Now people want to say, oh, patriarchy and all that jazz, I get it. But the reality is Paul uses the masculine word here because he deliberately is talking about us being sons, because the sons have more benefits than the daughters, particularly at that time. Okay? The sons inherited more of the father's estate, but also the sons were charged with keeping the family together. As sons of God, as children who have full status inheritance from the father, we are also charged then with keeping unity in the family. So we get all these wonderful things. We get the Spirit of God, which completes our adoption process. And we are made one with Christ, one with God. And it's, well, not one with God, but you know what I mean. We're made one with each other in God and in Christ. And that's so beautiful. And it's wonderful things that God's given us. But then He says, I have a job for you. Keep the family together. Maintain the unity. So the Spirit is pointing to the Father and is glorifying the Father in this process, where as He brings us into adoption, He's glorifying the Father. But the Father also then glorifies the Spirit by making it the Spirit who is the seal of our adoption and our entrance into the family of God. This whole sermon series has been an investigation into how God has revealed Himself to us, and who He has revealed Himself to us. Well, we see by the scriptures and by Jesus' teaching that God is indeed a triune God, seeking to glorify each other and share the love that is found in the person of the Trinity with all of mankind by bringing them back into relationship with Him as it existed in the Garden of Eden. That is the God who has revealed Himself to be. The Son points to the Father and the Spirit. The Spirit points to the Son and the Father. The Father points to the Son and the Spirit. Next week at Pentecost, we'll be diving into talking about the Spirit, talking about who He is and what He does. But for today, know that it is the Spirit who enables us to call the Father Abba. And that the Son makes it clear to us that the Father deeply loves all of us. Before I finish off, I do want to say a few things about things which have become more and more popular in the last decade or so. Seems fitting, as I said, because it's Mother's Day, to speak about this idea that is out there. If you haven't heard it before, don't worry, please. Like, I don't want to confuse you more. But there's this thing that is out there that people are teaching about Mother God, and they also talk about God being a woman. Okay? Now, I want to talk about the second point first. So firstly, God is spirit. And so is therefore outside the realm of gender and sex. All right? The Son is the Son because Jesus, as a human, is a male. That's pretty straightforward. But the Father and the Spirit are spirit, and so therefore have no gender. I did see a short video a while ago, I can remember a couple of months ago, claiming that God was non-binary. And I can see where the person is coming from, sort of, when I say God doesn't have a gender. The problem is that the term non-binary came from the world of gender politics, with the argument that gender is a spectrum and that non-binary exists outside the spectrum, but is also kind of part of it. It's all very a bit confusing. But as such, non-binary is a statement on gender, which God does not have. And so therefore, God is not non-binary, because his spirit, his outside realm of gender. Never mind the fact that God was the author and designer of gender and sex to begin with. And he made it clear that there's only two genders in the scriptures and can't be, you know, because there's only two genders, he can't fit into our definition of gender or spectrum of gender and talking about non-binary. It's all a bit of a mess. Long story short, God is spirit. There's no gender. If you hear people want to argue about God being non-binary, love them, please, because that's what we're called to do. First and foremost, love everybody. That's what we're called to do. But feel free to sit down and chat and talk about the fact that God is not gender. He has no gender. And it's not that it's non-binary. It's completely outside of that realm. Okay, so that's the first thing. All right. The second point is this idea of Mother God. Now, this I heard first when I was at university and not actually in one of my classes. There was some funny people around Stellenbosch at the time stopping students and basically saying, have you heard about Mother God? All right. Now, the argument was based on the fact that for the Son to be a Son, there had to have been a mother, because a mother and a father make a Son, meaning that Mother God existed for them, and also for humanity to be created in the image of God. Humanity, there's male and female, and so therefore, you know, God the Father is the image of all the males, and God the Mother is the image of all the females. There's also something to do with the wedding banquet parable and the wedding that we find in Revelation, and it's a whole also funny business. The final argument that they use is to talk about the fact that there's a number of female or feminine kind of attributes or qualities that are ascribed to God in the Old Testament. Okay, we did speak about this last week, and to make it 100% clear, this teaching is completely false. Okay, if in doubt, it's not true. There's no Mother God. There's no Heavenly Mother. That's not a thing. Okay. Yes, there is female imagery used to describe God and his relationship with people in the Old Testament. We talk about the mother hen gathering chicks underneath her wings. So we do see female things like that. We hear about God being gentle, kind, and loving, which are traits typically associated with women. But God has made it clear that in his revealing himself to humanity through the scriptures and through Jesus Christ, that he is Father. Men can typically have typical female attributes and vice versa. It goes to show that God isn't just the typical father, because he isn't an earthly father. He is our Father in heaven, who loves the world so much that he gave his Son and has filled us with his Spirit, who is the evidence of us being adopted into our family of God. Okay? Got it? Good? Happy? Got any questions? We can chat about it after the service. But those are the two things I just want to talk about. When talking about God being Father, these might sometimes come up, depending on the realms that you fly in. And if they do, just know this. And if you get a bit confused, come talk to me. It's fine. To come back to what Paul was talking about, which I think is vitally important for us. We are God's children. If we have given our lives to Christ, if we make him, if we are able to call him Lord and Master, he brings us to the Father. And the Spirit completes our adoption into the family. And by the three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are able to be free, not slaves to sin anymore, and know that we are part of God's family. I want to encourage you, in the world today, we see a lot of division in many aspects. And unfortunately, a lot of the division we find is in churches and amongst churches. I have spent my entire ministry career, if I say I started when I was 16 with Script Union camps, in spaces that are interdenominational, spaces where churches work together, spaces where we have to say, what are the core things we can agree on? What are the core things we believe? Everything else is secondary. And work together in unity for that. This is why I still maintain that as our young guys grow up, I want them to do Script Union camps. That's why I love having SU coming and all the mission awareness guides that we have. Because they are interdenominational. It is bringing around unity in God, because we are all one body as children in one family of God. Our Father. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for making it possible for us to come into the family of God. Holy Spirit, we thank you for being a spirit of adoption who seals that contract. And Father, we thank you that we can indeed call you Abba. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, may we seek unity amongst each other just as you are unified amongst yourself. And may we know that we are deeply loved by our Father in heaven. Let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who is in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.